Mike was mentioning the icebreaker this morning, the ship going forth into the frozen sea that breaks up and makes way for the passage. And I just felt, you know, we were talking about sound vibrations, and that when you turn to a, when everybody tunes together to a certain note, you're tuning to a certain vibration. And that this morning we need to vibrate together with God and his created voice. When he spoke, sound is a vibration. And that vibration was the creative force, right? That spoken word. Well, it doesn't ever stop. It just keeps going. And so every word we speak keeps going. Every word God has spoken keeps going. The universe is still expanding. It is still growing at the speed of sound and light. And I was just really thinking, the scripture came to my mind that everything that can be shaken will be shaken. There's a shaking going on. I get a little excited. I know it probably makes Mike a little nervous, but when we come in to have worship practice and it's completely chaos, I get excited. Because now we can't rely on our practice. Now we can't rely on, you know, the flesh gets a little, you know, shaken up. Well, let's put that aside and let's see what God has this morning. I wouldn't be so distracted if there wasn't something awesome that God wants to do. I've learned that my flesh doesn't like awesome things from God. My flesh wants to distract me and steal that away from me. So I tend to get excited. It defies logic, I know, but the worse things are around me, the more excited I get. That means God. I heard Jesse Duplantis a long time ago talked about your blessings are on layaway. And the more chaotic things get, the closer you are to redeeming your gifts on layaway. And don't forgo and turn away and give up right when you're at that point when God's getting ready to give the blessing, the breakthrough comes. Amen. Anyway, so having thought about that, I looked up the scripture about things being shaken. It's from Hebrews chapter 12. I'll read verses 23 through 29. Sheila, if you want to put those up there. Well, actually, I'm going to read out the Amplified, so never mind. And to the church, the assembly of the firstborn, who are registered as citizens in heaven, and to the God who is judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous, the redeemed in heaven, who have been made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator, the go-between, the agent of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood which speaks of mercy and better and nobler and more gracious message than the blood of Abel, which cried out for vengeance. To see to it that you do not reject him or refuse to listen to and heed him who is speaking to you now. For if they, the Israelites, did not escape when they refused to listen and heed him who warned and divinely instructed them here on earth, revealing with heavenly warnings his will, how much less shall we escape if we reject and turn our back to him who cautions and admonishes us from heaven? Then at Mount Sinai, his voice shook the earth, but now he has given a promise. Yet once more I will shake and make tremble not only the earth, but also the starry heavens. Now this expression, yet once more, indicates the final removal and transformation of all that can be shaken, that is, of that which was created, in order that what cannot be shaken may remain and continue. Let us therefore receive a kingdom that is firm and stable and cannot be shaken. Offer to God pleasing service and acceptable worship with modesty and pious care and godly fear and awe, for our God is indeed a consuming fire. We are of a kingdom that is unshakable. We cannot be shaken. The things around us can be shaken, but we are redeemed and we are placed at the right hand of Jesus, of God himself. We are with him, seated in heavenly places, and our kingdom cannot be shaken. He has promised that we cannot be shaken, but we must hold fast, right? We've talked a lot about fear. Fear steals. Fear destroys. All we have to do is believe. Do we really believe that we are now inheriting that kingdom, that we are now citizens of an unshakable kingdom? Because I believe the day is coming when that belief will be tested. We see things going on in the world right now. Christians hiding on a mountain, persecuted all around them, surrounded by people that want nothing but their heads. This world is an evil and a dying place. but we are the light and the hope of this world. We, the voice of the living God, are the hope of this world. Amen. And if we are not firmly rooted in that strong belief, how can we hope to ever save anybody around us? This is not really about us anymore. We know it's no longer us who live, but Christ who liveth in them. It's not about my life, what I accomplished, my legacy. It is about Jesus Christ and purveying him, being the manifestation of the sons and daughters on earth.
Amen.
In that, there is no fear. He goes before us, breaks the ice. He makes a way.
Yes.
He makes a way in those places where there seems to be no way.
Yes.
If there's a mountain, he will lay it low. If there is a desert, he will make it a vast garden, a fruitful plain. We have to trust and know that he knows our needs before we need them. We put our trust and our hope in him, a kingdom unshakable, a kingdom that we are heirs and joint heirs, leaders, kings and priests in this new nation. In Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right, anybody have any testimonies or prayer requests this morning?
Oh, yeah. I had a school friend run Armstrong that I knew growing up younger, and he gets these types of congestive heart failure, and I guess all my prayers to be with him. Since up on Facebook, he just wanted to make that friend when I lost my dad growing up. And I don't know what happened, but it's all over Facebook, and he's a good friend, and it's sad to see somebody like that. And probably maybe about the same age as I am, a little older, a little younger, I don't remember, but Ron, we're all praying for you. That's nothing to mess with.
Amen.
So,
all right, so yeah.
Healing for my sister Sherry and my brother-in-law Rich.
Okay. Sheila.
They're moving Evelyn to a different place this morning. Her whole point of moving is because she just feels like her ministry's not done where she is. She doesn't really have an opportunity to talk to too many people. So she just wants the Lord to open up doors of opportunity for her to spread Jesus.
Yes.
And so just pray for her and all that's going on. Diana Carpy's been having a lot of back pain. We prayed for her. Give a testimony, my daughter and about 10 friends were going down rafting on the river, and they were punctured and lost her keys and lost her cell phone, but they got out safe, her 8-year-old. It was a big ordeal to almost midnight trying to get somebody to come, but they never did get anybody to come and tow them away. But I'm just so grateful that God had his hand of protection upon them. She's mm-hmm. been trying to call me and Skyping me or whatever, and she's just like, Mom, I am so amazingly calm. I just cannot believe how calm I was telling Sally. You know, on Thursday, for some reason, I just started praying in tongues over all my kids,
yeah.
And especially for those guys. I didn't know what was going on, but the Lord knew, and that could have been, you know, what was going on, and the Lord could have saved them as a result, because they could have just kept on shooting down the river, she said. So
Amen.
Thank God for his hand of protection upon our kids.
Amen.
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 Yes, Lord. Yeah.
And so, when I thank the Lord, we went down to see our baby Anna, and I just thank the Lord to see how he's working her life. I mean, she's away from us now, but you can see sometimes that's the best time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when people say, you know, I come down a rope, you know, I'm down to the end, and I said, oh,
let's go stand before the Lord. And Heavenly Father,
thank
we just
Jesus.
Come before you today, Lord.
We bless you, Lord.
We lift
we
up these
you.
Needs,
thank
Lord,
you
members of our family,
cross,
friends, Lord, that need healing, Lord.
They
need a healing touch, Lord.
Healed,
in their mortal bodies, Lord. Bodies of flesh, Lord.
That
we speak life. We speak wholeness. We speak healing. Lord, into those bodies, Lord. We bind cancer. We bind congestive heart failure. We bind pain. We bind fear. We bind doubt. In your name, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that by your stripes, Lord, we were healed, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, that you said what we would lose on earth will be loose in heaven, Lord. What we bind on earth will be bound in heaven, Lord, by our word. By the word spoken from our mouth. Your word, the living word, the rhema word that comes forth from your believers, Lord. Your new creatures. A new creation, a new race on this earth. Born again. Kingdoms of heaven walking in mortal bodies, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you have made us kings and priests among your nation, Lord. Joint heirs with you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you have given us the authority to speak life in this earth, Lord, and to see life spring forth, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you have given us the word of healing, Lord, that when we speak it, healing must come. Thank you, Lord, that when you've given us the word of prosperity, Lord, that when we speak to those seeds, they must bear good fruit, Lord, for your kingdom, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the word of life and truth. Hope, Lord. That we put our hope and our trust in you, Lord. That you will never leave us. You will never forsake us, Lord. You never give up on us, Lord. That your love never fails, Lord. That you lift us up, Lord. When we doubt, when we fear, Lord, we cast those aside and we look to you. We put our hope and our trust in you, Lord, this day. And we lift up the name of Jesus. The name above all names, Lord, saying that you are worthy, Lord. That you are worthy, Lord, of our praise, Lord, of our worship, Lord. You alone, Lord. Oh, that there is none like you, Lord, that you came in flesh and laid down your life for your people, Lord, for your creation, Lord. Oh, that we might know you, Lord, that we might be like you. Lord, the mystery of the two becoming one, Lord, that it's no longer us who live, Lord, but your life, the abundant life that now comes forth. Our body, from our creation. Lord, the redeemed man, a new creation walking forth in power and authority sealed by your blood and by your spirit. Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you chose us for this day, for this age, Lord, to be messengers of grace, Lord, to be messengers of hope. Jesus, in this world, as this age comes to an end, let your light shine so brightly. Draw all men to your light, Lord, to your grace, Lord, that they might know your great love. Your great love, Lord, that saves all who call upon your name, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Oh, this day we enter your gates with praise. We enter your courts with thanksgiving. Lift up your name, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your people. Be with us this day, Lord. As we gather together in your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Eastern Gate House of Prayer, Friday, September 12th. Is that still Friday? Okay. 7 p.m. That is a week from this Friday, so anybody who can come, put that on the calendar. It's always a good time of praise and worship and warfare in Jesus' name. Let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer. And these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons. I speak in new tongues. I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, I am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the Word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Lord. John and Roberto, do you want to come take the offering this morning? Roberto, do you want to ask the blessing, please?
Glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. In this room, there's been so much talk about the river of God, and just want to love on Him this morning, just want to rejoice in Him this morning. And a few hours ago, as I was spending time with the Lord, He said to me, before you come to live your life for me, this would have been before 1980, things were really chaotic and crazy and stupid and everything in my life, but there was a wildness, there was an obnoxiousness, there was a no holding back, just letting it rip, tearing it up, whatever. And when I gave my heart to the Lord, getting filled with the Holy Ghost, everything was awesome in those times. But through the years, I realized that the wildness and the craziness and the energy, the enthusiasm was tucked somehow underneath of religiosity. Mm-hmm. To the point of, how should I say it? To the point of almost gagging. And every time I think of this, I think of being in this 910 person choir, almost cloned. We all had the choir robes on, and it was almost like cloned. It's scary. I mean, it was a blessing. I've learned a lot of things, and I know there's places for choirs, and God bless them and everything else like that. But I was losing who I was. There was a conformity. There's a craziness, and there's gifts that He has given us that,
exactly,
even though before we were using them for the wrong thing before we came to Him, don't give up. If the Lord wants you to cartwheel up and down the aisles and do things that you used to do, I know people would get up on tables and do stupid things and everything else like that, and swing around on fans and jump over things and holler and scream and whatever. So I hear of holy rollers. I haven't seen any. I've seen videos of them, but that's okay. And that's them expressing who they really are.
Exactly.
And for me to get high behind this stuff here and behind a pew or behind a soundboard or hiding in a drum stand, whatever, what's going on? Are we really free? Are we really free? So all I'm challenging you and me is I just want to get wild and crazy before the Lord. And David's wife, King David's wife, her name was Michael, I believe, she despised that. Because when the Ark of the Covenant was coming back into Jerusalem after the Philistines had it for years, he was going crazy. He was going nuts. He was breakdancing. He was doing everything in the street. And also his wife was just looking out the window and said, "You stupid fool." Well, guess what? I'd rather be that stupid fool out there doing that than be some uppity, snot-nosed, spoiled brat person looking out the window of someone who's rejoicing all the way that they know how in the Lord, okay? Yes. I know it's being videoed and broadcast, but you know what? I don't care anymore.
Let the poor man say, river flow. Dead man say, I
flow, Lord. Let it flow in this place, Lord. For your glory, Lord. For your glory, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
made testimony of how two of my older children have been retrieved from the enemy's camp. Okay? I still got two more to go, okay? My younger two. I ain't giving up. We're going to call the north and the south and the east and the west. The Lord knows where they're at. I know where they're at. And I call you back, Jesse and Joy Lynn, in the name of Jesus. You were all dedicated to the Lord when you were little, and that dedication still holds firm. The enemy unauthorized a stealing of them, but guess what? The Lord's word is stronger. The Lord's promises are yes and amen. Amen. So we're going to deliver on that. Hallelujah. Amen. Roberto, take it on, buddy.
Shout to the name.
north and the south and the east and the west. Hallelujah, Lord. My two younger ones praising the name of the Lord when they were little. In their own little way. I call it kindled fire. That coal that is within their being be ignited by the fire, the presence of the Holy Ghost. Touch, Lord. Touch, Lord. Touch, Lord. Touch me, Lord.
Thank you.
bring that next slide. This is in the spirit of those who we have cried out to right now. Right there. I declare it in the name of Jesus. Even if they don't know the Lord, even if they've never known the Lord, they are being called right now. They are being called right now.
Thank you. You know, in English, European and American, we say things like, we're going to learn this by heart, right? I mean, but in Hebrew, it's they learn by mouth. In other words, it's what we say. It's what we speak. It's what you really learn. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever had to study for tests. I was had a brief stint as an insurance salesman. Don't hold that against me. I also sold used cars one time, praise the Lord. I don't know which was higher on the scale or lower, but nevertheless, I had to pass an insurance test. And it was a pretty long and involved thing. And memorization has never been a strong point for me. I remember all of the senseless stuff, the inane, you know, I can remember things that have no bearing on anything in the world, but give me a fact, and it's like it just flies right through one ear and out the other. But I did learn over the process of preparing to take this test that if I read out loud, not just try to memorize an answer for the test, but actually read the information out loud to myself, I remembered it. I was surprised that I remembered it, to be quite honest with you, because when I took the test, I didn't think I remembered anything when I got there. And as I began to take the test, I realized stuff just started coming out of my head. And it's because I had said it all before. Now, I'm sure there was a couple of other people that were taking it at the same time. The Iowa Insurance Commissioner, you know, they oversee the whole thing, and they probably thought I was a derelict or something because I was talking to myself all the time. I was saying it out loud, you know. But I did pass the test. I didn't sell insurance for very long, but I did pass the test. It cost me more to take the test, I think, than I ever made selling insurance, to be honest with you. But anyway, that's another story for another day. Hallelujah. But God had other things in mind. But anyway, what I'm saying is. We really learn by mouth, by what we say. We think we're memorizing things, by heart, but the truth is we learn far more. It resonates with us personally far more when we speak things. And that's why God says it's because we're spirit beings to begin with that we declare. We have to say Amen. Just as God did. We're created in His image and after His likeness. God speaks and things are. We need to do the same thing. So whatever you're confronted with, whatever situation or circumstance, you need to speak to that thing. I said here Wednesday night, you know, we don't realize we're prophesying all the time. Every time we open our mouth, it's prophetic because we're spirits. Right? So you want to be careful what you're prophesying. You don't want to be saying stuff you don't want. So we speak to the reality of what we want according to God's word. Whether it's healing, whether it's restoration in relationships, whether it's financial, whatever it is. This isn't just the power of positive thinking. This isn't just a gimmick. This is who and what we are. Amen? There's power in words. Praise the Lord. So we need to realize that. We need to operate from that. I'm just rambling a little bit here this morning. Praise the Lord. And I'll continue to till I figure out where to go from next. Praise the Lord. But this preacher was walking down the street one day and he saw this little girl. Poor little thing. And she was reaching for the bell, you know, the doorbell on this house. And she just couldn't quite reach it. And she was standing on her tiptoes and just really straining. And so he went over and he said, "Can I help you?" And she said, "Please." And he rang the doorbell, rang it again. And then the little girl looked up at him and she said, "Run!" Hey, okay, well, praise the Lord sometimes. Hallelujah. No good deed goes unpunished, right? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, everything about the kingdom of God is about the Spirit. And, you know, even we read things, and because we have this carnal kind of fleshly way of looking at things so often, even in the church, it's a religious kind of behavior and attitude, but nevertheless, it seems to dominate in a lot of our lives, or at least it certainly has in the past. Hopefully not so much anymore, but when you look at scriptures like in John chapter 15, where Jesus is talking about he's the vine and we're the branches, and that by being in him we bear fruit, and we forget that in a vine, it's not like a tree. It's referred to as a tree in one of the Gospels, but he's talking about a vine that, like, grapes grow on. And there's just a continuation of the vine. I mean, you know, if you've ever seen a vineyard, you know grapevines are just grapevines. You've got you could call it the trunk where it comes out of the ground, but it's still just a vine, and it just continues on out into the outer parts of the vine, where the fruit then is developed or is produced. It's actually produced in the vine, but it appears, amen, on the branch. And in John chapter 15, where he talks about that, he says, "Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away." Now, we've read that and thought, you know, I don't know if I'm producing enough fruit here. And what does that mean? That God's going to take me away? That God's going to do bad to me? But in fact, that word, I was just looking at this morning, is that word to take away is A-I-R-O, the Greek word, and it's A-I-R-O. And it means literally to raise up, to lift, to take upon oneself and carry what has been raised. You know, for years I've heard that and read that thinking, if I'm not doing everything I should be doing, God's going to get me. When in fact what God is saying here, just like in a true grapevine, if you've seen them, vines, they're not like pumpkins and gourds. They don't run on the ground. Grapevines, they have to be on an arbor or on a trellis of some kind. And if they if they start bearing fruit and they get heavy, they'll fall to the ground unless they're lifted up and then attached to the trellis or whatever it is so that it can bear more fruit. Because if it gets on the ground, it gets dirt on it, doesn't get sunlight, and then they begin to rot so that they don't get, you don't get the benefit of it. So what God is saying is, you know, even as he goes on to talk about purging for more fruit, but he says, you know, if they're not putting on fruit, I'm going to lift them up. I'm going to raise them up higher where they get more sun, where they get the benefit of the vine and all that's available to it. And that's what God wants us to understand. You know, he's not against us. He's for us in every area. You know, he produces, we just bear fruit. It's not our work. I was thinking when Suzanne was talking earlier, she was reading from Hebrews chapter 12. I was reading there with her in the King James, and where it says, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. You can't serve God without grace. Not acceptably. And it's the same thought that's in this idea of him being the vine and we being the branches. Except you abide in me, you can't produce any fruit. It's just staying connected. It's just realizing this is a spiritual thing. It's not a physical thing. In fact, Jesus, in the whole act of redemption and salvation, Jesus identified with us, humanity. The way he did that was by being born in the flesh so that he could relate. So he identifies with us. But we identify with him in just the opposite. We identify with Jesus by the Spirit, not by his flesh. He said the flesh can't do anything, right? It's the Spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. So he identifies with us in the flesh, and we need to identify with him in the Spirit, because that's what he's made available to us. That's the idea that I want to speak to you about this morning. Amen. And let's begin in Isaiah 54. No, Isaiah 53. And we'll just read verses 10 and 11 just to give you an idea of what I'm talking about. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Now, I want to come back to this in a minute, but first I want to read from John chapter 16, 13, where he says that the Holy Spirit is given to us to lead us and to guide us into all truth. John 16, 13, yeah. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. Now let's go back to Isaiah. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Now, in John, he says that he's to guide us into the reality of the redemptive work of Christ. I'm just saying that's what he's saying there. In John chapter 16, verse 13. He's going to guide us, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit, right, guides us into the reality of the redemptive work of Christ. Now, God is a Spirit, right? the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. He what he's going to do is the same thing Jesus said he was doing when he was here. It's not me that's doing the works. I only say what the Spirit says. Right? I only do what the Spirit does. Right? Now, the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit recreates us through the Word of God. Right? Everything that Christ accomplished in his substitution was accomplished in his Spirit. Praise the Lord. As human beings, and the church, you know, as a religious entity, is so hung up and so tied up with sense knowledge that they only see the physical suffering of Christ on the cross. They only see his physical resurrection. That's the major focus that we've heard about and dealt with, you know, all of our quote-unquote Christian lives. But there was something that was far beyond that. His Spirit was suffering for our spirits. His Spirit was made righteous for our spirits. It was his Spirit that was for the resurrection of our spirits. Praise the Lord. Let's look at 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Because so much of what we do gets tied up in our flesh that we miss what this thing is really all about. Amen. This did not get born again. What got born again was the Spirit. And yet, because I'm always identifying with the physical act, I'm always relating it to my physical person. So Jesus never called me to do what he did in terms of his behavior. Nobody, not one person, has ever lived this Christian life outside of Christ. It's not about, I can't do it because I'm not good enough. It's impossible. The only way it's possible is if it's not me living it, but him. It's no longer my life, but he lives through me. And he does that by the Spirit. I just have to abide. I just have to stay connected. And I do that by grace. I do that by focusing on him and not on me. He can produce fruit. I don't have to worry about producing fruit. I just got to be available. I just have to be connected. I don't produce fruit. That's the first thing where the church has missed it. It's told us we're supposed to be producing fruit. And if you don't, you're going to be in big trouble with God. But God says it's impossible for you to produce fruit. And if you are not bearing fruit, not producing, but if you're not bearing fruit, I'll pick you up. I'll lift you up. In other words, grace, it's what he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll produce more. Connect with me. Yoke up with me, and you'll see production. But it won't be you producing. It'll just be you abiding. You're just going for the ride. It's God that does the works. Amen. So according as his divine power hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. When God imparts to us his nature, there comes with it all of the attributes of God. You can have the nature of God without having the attributes of God. But it's not here. It's in here. It's the Spirit. We become one. Now, we have all these attributes of God based on God's own word. Amen. But they are undeveloped. They're there, but they're lying latent in the human spirit. You've got him. You're not going to get him. You've already got him. You got him the moment you were born again. You got the, you received the nature of God based on the promise of God. And the nature of God, you can't have the nature of God without having the attributes of God, or you wouldn't have his nature. But just because you have them doesn't mean that they're active.
Exactly.
They're dormant, in other words, or latent, if you will. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. What I'm endeavoring to do, along with some other things that I don't even know about, is to get us to understand and to realize, first and foremost, we are spirits. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. This is a flesh, natural world. We're in it, but this isn't where we belong. This isn't where we're from. We were born from above. We're here, but we're ambassadors of a spirit realm. But to represent that spirit realm, we got to know something about it. Otherwise, we end up just aping, mimicking the world that's around us, only we try to be a better human. Well, you're not going to be a better human because you're not really a human in the first place. You're a new creation, a God-man, a God-person. Amen. You got his nature. That's what you are. That's what's happened. That's what happens when you get born again. So, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. It was the Spirit that was made sin. I'll let you think about that, meditate on it, and you can email me later and tell me where I'm wrong. Praise the Lord. But it's the spirit of man that is made righteous. Right? And we were made righteous with what? With his righteousness. This righteousness that's imparted to the human spirit gives the human spirit a sense of freedom. A sense of liberty, whom the Son sets free. Free indeed. It's supposed to. And that sense of freedom, that sense of liberty, is something that we have with God that man hasn't known since before the fall. Adam and Eve were not freaked out about the presence of God. They were totally comfortable in his presence. Scripture talks about walking with him, and it wasn't until the fall that they freak out when God shows up. He came in the day, in the cool of the day, like he always did. He was there every day. They weren't troubled by it. They weren't upset about it. They weren't even aware of themselves, physically speaking. They were relating to God spirit to spirit. They were in the body, but they weren't relating to God from their body. They were relating to God from their spirit until they fell, and then immediately it's about not having clothes on, and you know, it's all about now, it's about them, it's about their flesh. So what God has given us by the Spirit is this freedom, this righteousness that is supposed to bring us back into a no sin consciousness, to where we have liberty and freedom to walk with God openly, with no sense of inferiority, with no sense of separation, or, but it's spirit. It's by the Spirit. We cannot be focused and causing everybody to focus on flesh, on good behavior, bad behavior, ups and downs, and all of that stuff. This is about the Spirit. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 8 and 9, this is where it talks about Adam and Eve being, you know, busted, basically, for their sin or their fall or separation from God, disobedience. They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord, from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? Now the trees in the garden were the trees, and I'm just using the scriptural kind of metaphor here, but there were all lots of trees apparently, but there were two major trees in the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Well, now they lived from the tree of life And now all of a sudden, they're hiding. You know, there's a knowledge of good. There's a knowledge of evil. And they're aware that in the flesh, they're far from perfect. That they're not like God. Amen. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where are you? Now God knew exactly where they were. He wanted them to know where they were. He wanted them to understand. Because before the fall, man had perfect fellowship with God, perfect relationship with God. But after the fall, look at the same chapter, verse 23 and 24. Now, we've been redeemed. Amen. To be redeemed means to be put back in the original position. Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life. So now man becomes dependent on his senses. You better be listening up because there's wild animals out there. Mm-hmm. Keep your nose in the wind. Could be a fire. Amen? You know, better be feeling your way around. There's stuff here that can cause infections and poison and ivy and sumac and who knows, God knows what else. You know? Now all of a sudden, they're going to survive by their senses. They're going to live by their senses or die by their senses. Man's spirit becomes a slave to his senses. Sadly, that's where much of the church is today. Even though we've been redeemed, we're still slaves to the senses, which keeps us from having the liberty and the freedom that whereby we've been saved. When the senses gained the supremacy, man lost all real knowledge of spiritual things. Even what we think of as spiritual knowledge is tainted by senses. Even in the church. And most of us, if we're honest with ourselves, would have to say that even what we know to be spiritual motions, if you will, are still distorted by our senses. And we're looking a lot of times for a spiritual manifestation when in fact what we're really looking for is a sense manifestation. I want to feel something. I want to see. I mean, listen, just, do you ever think about when you hear these guys talk about, and there was a light and there was a cloud over the platform? And I'm not trying to belittle that. I'm saying that is a lower experience than to have a spirit-to-spirit interaction with God just based on his word. An audible voice. It's a sense. That's why you see it all the time in the Old Testament, because they didn't have the Spirit. They had to have a visual. They had to have a sound. They had to see some smoke. They had to smell some smoke. They had to have something natural for them to relate to. And it's sad that the church has perpetuated this idea, even though we're in a totally different covenant. We're in one where now we're to be led by the Spirit. The Holy Spirit is going to come and lead us and guide us into all truth. Exactly. Not from one vision to the next. Exactly. I'm saying we're looking for a revival of the flesh. I'm not saying God doesn't give us physical manifestations, because we do have a human body. But when we crave that, when that's what we're praying for, when that's what we're looking for and expecting, we're putting God on almost on a human level. Instead of saying, God, do what you do. And we'll receive it by faith. If we're not experiencing revival, it may be that we don't really know what revival is. We're looking for another physical experience when God's trying to lead us to a higher place. He's trying to pick up the vine and raise it up to where it can really begin to produce some fruit, amen, not just a little bit of fruit, but a great abundant harvest,
yes.
Amen? If the fruit is revival, if the fruit is people being saved, maybe we're only having limited revival and limited manifestations of salvation in people's lives because we're looking for the wrong thing. We're trying to produce it, and only God can produce it. Our job is to abide in Him.
Amen.
Our job is to just stay connected with Him and let Him produce the fruit.
Yes.
By the Spirit. Let the Spirit lead us and guide us.
Amen.
He directs the steps of the righteous. We are where we are. We do what we do. We interact with who we interact for a reason. Because the Holy Spirit is leading us and guiding us, directing our steps so that we can reveal truth, so that truth can be revealed to us, God's fruit being manifest, and so that others can see the fruit. I just say, look, we should pray for direction and so on and so forth, but I'm saying we ought to just live. We ought to just be walking in the garden and just naming,
yes,
giraffe, you know. First thing God gave man to do was to speak.
Yes, he did.
Because He wanted him to be like Him.
Uh-huh.
We ought to just be speaking to stuff, speaking to people, speaking to circumstances. We ought to just be declaring. We've got a right to. We have all the attributes of God, and we're not even using them.
Come on.
Because we don't see it the right way, because it isn't maybe expressed the right way. Listen, however you express it, that's the right way.
Yeah.
Amen. You're unique, a unique creation. God doesn't want us all to be clones, as Mike was talking about. We are who we are and the way we are for a specific reason, because we can influence specific people. Tim can touch people's lives that I can't reach. They won't even talk to me. And I'm not talking about the color of skin. I'm talking about who we really are. He's got a personality that's different than mine.
Yes.
He has access to people's and relationships that I don't have.
That's right.
And that's true of every one of us.
Yeah.
You ever try to talk to somebody and you try and try and try and they just shut you off as if, you know, you're speaking a foreign language. And somebody else comes along and says the very thing that you've been saying, and all of a sudden they go, hallelujah, I've seen the light.
Yeah.
Well, you've been blinded. Because I've been shining that light on your face for the last 5 years, 10 years, whatever. But there's some kind of a connection there that the Holy Spirit uses. Praise God. At the time of the Abrahamic covenant, and I don't know if we really think about this that much, senses absolutely controlled man. When God called Abram out of Ur of the Chaldees, man was totally sense-controlled. It took some time because Adam and Eve were still, they had it fresh in their mind at least. Even though they had to operate by their senses now, they still had a memory of that spirit relationship. And they tried to pass it on. But with each succeeding generation, it becomes diminished. It becomes less. It becomes like our revivals.
Right.
You know, it got to be like, oh, how we. I remember when I received baptism of the Holy Spirit, and I had people telling me, you know, what they did. I always make the joke, you know, they outran a freight train. They couldn't speak English for 10 days or whatever. You know, I mean, everybody had a bigger story. And I'm not saying it wasn't true. Maybe it was true, maybe it wasn't. But it always seemed like the previous generation was always just something bigger. It was always a bigger deal, something more profound or what have you. And it's kind of that way with when we look at revival back to the, the outpouring, you know, Azusa Street and that whole time, you know, around the turn of the century. And that's kind of the way it was with each succeeding generation, that experience. I don't know if it actually diminishes or there just seems to be a distance from it. And that's kind of what's happens with each succeeding generation. After Adam and Eve, it becomes more of a what grandpa had, you know, what mom, dad experienced, until it got to the point where it was almost a myth, almost a fable. It really wasn't that real anymore. They still tried to go by it. They were still offering sacrifices and so forth, but it was all about the senses now. They really had no real spiritual connection, whatever connection they had with God, and there were many gods, obviously, but whatever that relationship was, it really wasn't spiritual anymore. It had become a fleshly thing, a physical act or behavior that you had to perform, which is why you had everything from prostitution to drugs and everything else. And I'm not talking about in Judaism, because Judaism really didn't exist at that point, but within religion. Within people's reaching for God or trying to experience something in God. They were trying to have some kind of, what I'm saying is they were looking for some kind of spiritual experience, but they didn't know what it was.
Yeah.
So they just looked for a different physical experience and call that spiritual.
Right.
Anybody that lived in the 60s knows something about what I'm talking about. Or if you ever read anything about what happened in the 60s. But the truth is it happens in every generation.
Right.
We're trying to find God, without Spirit. We're doing whatever we can do. Whatever we do, people do because they really want a spiritual experience. They're just trying a physical way to have it. So that's what was going on. Abraham was, or Abram as he was called originally, was evidently the only one of his day who had any spiritual discernment. Somehow through his life, through his experiences, through his parents, grandparents, I don't know how, but somehow there was still a flicker, a little flame of spiritual discernment there. Because when God spoke to him, look, God's wanting to reach out to everybody. But for whatever reason, Abram responded. He had to have some sense of spiritual discernment that the people around him weren't experiencing. Amen? He believed, the Bible says he believed God's word in the face of the testimony of his senses. It was unheard of. It was unusual. It was rare. You got people cutting themselves. I'm talking about back then. I know that that even happens today. But religiously, trying to get a feeling. Trying to express something spiritual, trying to show themselves to be something that they really weren't. But somehow, Abram had this discernment. And I've said this before, but it bears repeating. No religion, none at all, has ever dealt with the human spirit. No religion. You pick one, and I'll guarantee you, it does not deal with the human spirit. All religion has been connected to the senses. From time immemorial, as far back as you go, it's just the way it is. We've preached the ethics of Christianity instead of the reality that makes up Christianity. We've preached sense worship. We've preached sensual religion instead of the reality of Christ, of Christianity, which is a spiritual relationship. Let's look at John chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Praise the Lord. See, we need to know who we are. It's not enough to be somebody. We need to know who we are.
Exactly.
I'll never forget one time, years ago, we were starting a church in Ankeny. It was with another organization. In fact, there is a church that exists there to this day. But we were having a tent meeting. I was going to bring back old-time Pentecost, praise the Lord, because I thought that's how it worked. So we had a big tent, and it was in the back of the building that we were using for a church, and big vacant lot. Cops came. I mean, there was a whole bunch of stuff that happened. It turned out to be all right. But this friend of mine who was a pastor, who I was a good friend of mine, Sally knew, but I'm not going to say who it was, but nevertheless, he pastored a church here in Iowa, southern Iowa. I preached for him a bunch of times. He preached for me. In fact, he came and helped with the church for a while after he left the organization. I was still in the organization, but I let him preach in my church because nobody else would let him. He was a good preacher. He just didn't agree with all of the stuff. And but nevertheless, he and his wife were having a little, believe it or not, husbands and wives, pastors and wives, they have arguments. Not us, but I mean the average, the normal, the regular ones. Yeah, they have disagreements, they have, just like everybody, because, we're human. So I don't want to pop your bubble in case you thought everything was perfect, but it's good, but it's just not perfect. Anyhow, nevertheless, they were talking, and of course, I was pretty naive yet. I wasn't a young kid. I mean, I was nearly 40 years old, but I still had, because of the religious training, I thought, you got to be perfect. So I carried around quite a burden for not being perfect, but I expected everybody else to be perfect, because especially if they were preachers, She said something really catty and snide. He probably deserved it because he was a funny guy. I mean, he made me laugh, so I knew he probably was irritating the crap out of his wife. Nevertheless, she said something, and there were people around, and he turned to her and he said, "Talk to me like I am somebody." He was upset. "Talk to me like I am somebody." And I almost started laughing because I thought at first he was joking. Then I realized, hey, he's dead serious. He's upset. And from that time on, I always thought, we don't talk to ourselves as if we're somebody, let alone anybody else. Right? I mean, we ought to see that we are somebody. I mean, you don't influence if you don't think you have any influence. But if you realize the somebody that you are, we might get bold. We might just step right up and say something and prophesy something and declare something over a person. Amen. See their lives change. See circumstances change. You know what I mean? Yeah. Praise the Lord. So, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things that were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. Amen? Everything's about words. All right? Verse 12. But as many as received Him, to them gave He power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name. Now, He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly, right? John 1:4, if you can, Sheila, go back to that. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. He came that we might have life and that we'd have it more abundantly. But in Him's the life, and that life is what is the light of men, or the revelation to man. The literal translation there is, in Him was life, and that life is the creative ability of God in man. That's the literal translation. In Him was life, and that life is the creative ability of God in man. And what is that creative ability? To speak, to say to things that are not, that they become. We have this nature, these attributes. And we're still stumbling around out here operating in the flesh. All creative ability is God's ability. Yeah. I'm going to repeat that. All creative ability is God's ability. God has imparted this ability to the spirit of man. We are created in the image and after the likeness of God. God is a spirit. Jesus coming in flesh was to identify with us, not to reveal the look of God. His spirit came. The spirit of God came in a man, Jesus, for him to identify with us, not for us to identify with God. We identify with God by the spirit of Christ. Amen. That's why Jesus said, it's not me that's doing the works. It's the Father that's in me. It's the spirit that's in me. He does the works. Right? The words that I speak are spirit and they are life. Praise the Lord. John 4, verse 23. See, we just need a sea change, amen, in the way that we think and the way that we operate. But the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. We can't connect to God through the flesh. I mean, the reason for worship, the reason for music, the reason for testimonies is to get us in the spirit. Not to get us focused on the flesh. Amen? What Mike was talking about is true. God just let it, whatever, you know, it doesn't matter. I'm not saying you have to do anything, but I'm just saying if you feel it, go ahead. It's no big deal. It's your spirit simply trying to express. The problem becomes when we start having victory marches and judging people on whether how high they jump and how loud they shout, because that's what happens in a religious setting, is pretty soon if you ain't shouting, they got you in the altar and praying you back through because they know you got some kind of sin. Because you're just not free. And there may not be anything wrong with you except that your human personality is not such that it yields itself to more demonstrative kind of behavior. We're different. I don't want you to be me. God doesn't want you to be me. He wants you to be you. So when we start getting this uniform kind of thing, and this is what we do, and I remember I sat in a lot of shirts. I got to where, man, I'd be in the flesh just like that. You tell me I got to get up and get into a victory march, and I am carnal. I'll get in the march, but nothing spiritual is going to happen in me because I'm so focused on the fact that here I am marching around in this, you know, cha-cha line without cha-cha, you know. You got to fix me. You know, I'm feeling like an idiot. Now, other people are probably getting the victory, you know, but not me because I'm now totally absorbed with myself. Praise the Lord. That's what I'm saying. It's a liberty between you and God. It's a freedom. It's a relationship between you and God. You have the right to worship any way you feel led to worship. If you want to get up and shout, if you want to run the backs of those pews, have at it. I wouldn't say a word. I'd be all for it. I'd just cheer you on. But don't wait for me to follow you, because I may not ever get to the back of that pew. Amen. It's just that's what I'm saying. We can't get everybody to conform to something that God really isn't interested in the first place. He's after our true worship. Spirit and truth. The truth that I'm feeling. The reality of who I am is my true worship by the Spirit. Well, I just want to touch him. I don't care what the person sitting next to me thinks, or if they think I'm in the Spirit, if they don't think I'm in the Spirit. You know what I mean? I don't have to prove, because in my trying to prove that to somebody else, I'm distancing myself from the Spirit. I'm focusing on the flesh. I'm focusing on somebody else's judgment of me or critiquing of me. Right. Praise the Lord. All right, Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7. And this just carries on the same thought, that as a man thinketh, so is he. Right? Well, that's interesting, but... Oh, somebody write that down. I may have to go back to that later. But anyway, See, there's lots of stuff in the Bible that we don't always focus on too much. But for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. As he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Here's what I'm saying. Every bit of knowledge that's been gained throughout time, every bit of knowledge that has been gained throughout time has come to us through the five senses, with the exception of revelation knowledge. You understand what I'm saying? We didn't create something. We have knowledge. And that knowledge comes through our senses. Humans have a mind that receives all of their, well, the mind itself receives all of its impulses from the five senses. We talk about genius. Yeah, there's genius, but they're not creative. They just have developed the use of those impulses to a higher degree than somebody else. But it's still just impulse. It's still a sensual thing. It's still something that comes through their senses. The human mind has no creative ability. Now, I know New Agers and lots of other progressives and others would argue that, but it's the truth, whether they want to admit it or not. The human mind cannot invent. You say, well, what about Henry Ford? That's not creativity. That's operating based on impulse, on sense knowledge, on knowledge that they've learned and they apply it in a certain way. It's called experiments. But it's not creative. You don't take nothing and make something out of it. We have to have information to create it. Quote unquote, create anything. We're not creating. We're simply applying the knowledge through experiments, through trial and error, until something happens. And then we go, oh, he created the automobile. No, all the things for the gasoline, for the combustion engine, were all there. He didn't create any of that. He just put the pieces together. It's not creating, it's operating on the impulses of knowledge of the brain. We call it creating, but it's not creating. Correct. Creating, you got to have nothing and begin with nothing in order to make something. That's creative. Right. Our definitions are screwed up, but that doesn't make it true. Right. The human brain can experiment, but it can't develop anything that its senses haven't already brought to it. Right. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. I know this is bursting our bubble as being these wonderful beings, but it's the truth. The imagination can only build pictures out of material that the five senses have brought to it. Any imagination I have, any dream that I have, anything else, has to come from some information that I've gotten somewhere. It may be psychological, it may be subconscious. But there had to have been information imparted to my brain for me to create a dream or an imagination of something. I'm not imagining something that I haven't been given information about. And neither is anybody else. The natural human mind has no creative element in it. Being born again, something happens. We have a recreated spirit, right? But the mind is not recreated. It's still subject to the senses. This is the conflict. Praise the Lord. Look at Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Have our minds renewed by the Word of God. That's this whole spiritual reality. And I'll show you what I mean. Here's another scripture that's often taken out of context, but I want to put it in the context of what the scriptures are trying to actually tell us. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Why present the body as a living sacrifice? Because it's the house of the five senses. That's what he's talking about. He's not talking about go out and beat yourself up or, you know, crucify yourself. He's saying you need to present this sensory thing whereby you're receiving all your information. You need to put that before God and operate by the Spirit. Get out of that sense realm. Sacrifice that sense realm so that you can be a recipient of the Spirit, so that the Spirit can operate through you. Amen? Don't be conformed to this world, because this world operates totally by sense knowledge. And just because you're in church don't mean that you have not continued to operate in the senses. Because your spirit got born again, your sensory organ, or the main distribution point for the senses, is right here, and it didn't get born again. Praise the Lord. So you have to then be transformed so that your natural behavior is supernatural, so that it aligns with who you really are in the Spirit. And the way that you do that is renew your mind so that you can prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. What's the good, acceptable, perfect will of God? The Spirit, the endeavors of the Spirit, the work of the Spirit. You can't know that through the flesh. Praise God. So, look at Romans chapter 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation, right? There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. See, the reason there's no condemnation is because you're not operating by your senses. You're operating by the Spirit. Well, so what is spirituality? That becomes the next great debate, is are you being spiritual enough then? Walking in the Spirit. Are you in the Spirit? I mean, are you doing all this spiritual stuff? So what's spirituality? Spirituality is the recreated spirit gaining the ascendancy over the reasoning faculties and thereby ruling the whole man. Back to the redemption. Back to what we were redeemed for. So that now the Spirit has the ascendance, has the high point of action above the flesh, casting down every imagination, anything that tries to exalt itself above the Word of God, which is the Spirit. Praise the Lord. Once that happens, you can be ruled by the Spirit again. Look at John 10:10. The thief comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I'm come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. Why are those two, you know, they're in the same grammatical phrase here? It's because what is it the thief is coming to steal, to kill, and to destroy? The spiritual side of you. He's trying to keep you focused in the sense realm. That's where his strength is. But Jesus has come to give us life, and life more abundantly. What is that? That life is the nature of God. It's the Spirit. Amen? We were born of the Spirit. We are spiritual beings. The life that I now live, Paul said, I don't live it by the flesh, but by the power of Christ through me. The life of Christ in me. Amen? The Spirit life. Okay, John, again, let's go back to the beginning where we started. John 16, 13. We're just about wrapped up here. A couple more scriptures and we'll be done. John 16, 13. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he won't speak of himself, But whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He brings the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of God, or Spirit of Christ, however you want to dice that up. He brings the ability of God, and he builds it into us. Praise the Lord. He opens up the Word, and he makes it a living thing to us. So it's just not words on a book. It's not a history book. It's not just, I mean, you ever think about the difference between you and an unbeliever? When you look at the Bible, you go, it's power. This is powerful. And they look at it and they think, what? It's idiotic. Right?
Yeah.
It becomes alive to us. It becomes a living reality. To them, it's just, you know, it's just another book. The Holy Spirit is doing exactly what Jesus promised he would do. Amen? He guides our spirit. He guides our reasoning faculties into the realm of the reality of the new creation. Did that make any sense to anybody? He's leading us and guiding us into all truth. He leads us into the reality of the new creation.
Yes.
But see, when we operate by the senses, that's too big. It doesn't work. Because we're still measuring ourselves among ourselves, which is not wise.
Correct.
We're still measuring everything by our flesh, by our successes and our failures and everything else. When he's trying to lead us away from that into the reality of who we are in this new creation. Spirit man. With the ability of God. With the nature of God. Right? That's what he's doing. He's constantly trying to confirm that. So when we're walking in the Spirit, we are not under condemnation. You know, we're no longer under condemnation because that we're not walking in the flesh. We're not walking by our senses anymore. We're walking according to what the Spirit says, what the Word of God says. That's the difference. That's the only difference. Romans 5:17, last scripture. For if by one man's offense death reigned, by one, right, by Adam, if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. See, he's telling us we reign as kings in this new realm, in this spirit realm. We are kings and priests. Praise the Lord. His grace that we talked about back that Suzanne mentioned, I read Hebrews. See, wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Praise the Lord. His grace has made us new creations. Now, let this sink in. He has made us out of himself. Created in Christ Jesus. He made us out of him. We can create. Because it's all done by the Spirit. We have creative ability. We can speak to things that are not.
Amen.
As though they are. And they shall come to pass. Even as God spoke to nothing.
Exactly.
And said light, and light was.
Exactly.
That's creative. That is why we call it the creation. Now, if you ever get a hold of this, there'll never be another day of lack in your life. Because you can speak to your situation. You can speak to your circumstances. You can speak to your relationships. You can speak to your finances. I don't care what it is. If you don't let the enemy steal from you by sucking you back into this sense realm to where you're going by what is in the bank account or what somebody says as a response to what you say or to your symptoms. That's how he's using, that's how he's stealing from you. That's how he robs you. That's how he destroys. He gets you into the sense realm where he has control, where he has power. You rule as a king and a priest, but you rule there in a realm of the new kingdom, amen, of the Spirit. The beauty of it is you can bring everything out of that Spirit into this natural realm.
Amen.
But you can't take anything out of this realm into the Spirit. It's temporary. It's only going to be here for a while. But the things that are permanent, are eternal, are the things of the Spirit. They don't fluctuate. They don't go up and down. They're always constant. That's supernatural. That is the miraculous. And that's who you are. You came out from him. He made you out of himself. So that you can be an heir and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. You can walk on water. You can cast out demons.
Amen.
Amen. You can heal the sick. You can raise the dead.
Yes.
You can create.
Yes.
Because you're of the Creator. Hallelujah. But it takes an entire lifetime's worth of thinking has to go out the window. And the sad truth is, it's not just your lifetime, it's the generations that went before you that you have been fed by. I'm saying, I don't care about any revival that's ever been. Thank God for every revival that's ever been. But I want a spirit revival.
Yes.
I want something that will shake this planet like nothing has ever shook it before, outside of the original words that God spoke that brought it into existence. Everything has been catch-up since then. Everything has been trying to reproduce, reconjure, refigure. And God wants us. He says, I'm going to do a new thing. What's a new thing? That would be what I call create.
Yes.
That would be a new thing. Everything else is a used thing that we're just fixing up. We've polished it up, we've shined it up, and we've repackaged it and said, here, this is new, when in fact it's not new. It's not a creative move of God or effect of God. It's simply something we've fashioned after something that God created originally.
Right.
And then try to package it or promote it as though it were another creative act of God. When God wants creative acts from his people, that brings glory to him. Then people look at you going, ooh, that must be one of his kids. Right? That's what God wants, for his glory to cover the earth the way the seas, water covers the seas. Amen?
Amen.
Give him a hand clap. Praise the Lord. So Jesus said, nothing shall be impossible for them that believe.
Amen.
Nothing. You know, to me, it makes those things believable. You say, well, you mean you didn't believe it before? Well, yeah, I believed it, but in a kind of an existential way. But this, with this kind of understanding, I believe it as though, yeah. It's like, it's my shirt. I know it's mine. I took it out of my closet and put it on my back. I paid for it when it went to the cleaners. It's mine. It's a real thing. You know, it's not somebody's opinion. It's not what somebody else said or did, but it's a fact. And that's why we need our minds renewed. No matter how long it takes, it'll be worth it. If one day of living truly, completely by the Spirit, it would make a lifetime worthwhile. You would experience God in you to the ultimate, that it can be experienced and still have a body. And that's that's what God wants for every one of us. Amen?
Amen.
So we need to start talking. We need to start prophesying and realize every time we open our mouth, that's what we're doing. We're prophesying. We're not just shooting the breeze. We're not just gabbing, you know. What we're saying, angels are listening to.
Yes.
Yeah.
They're looking for orders. And some of the stuff we say, I bet we all have angels that are personal to us. I bet I've had mine running in circles, pulling out their hair, thumping each other, getting angry and fist fighting and everything else with each other because this guy's driving me crazy. He doesn't make any sense. His back is killing him. What? Should we kill him? You're killing me here. You know, the traffic. Ah, God, come on. Oh, we'll always be in debt. Whoa, do you suppose he really means? Yeah, well, he said it. You see what I'm saying? Those, they may sound simple and simplistic, but we do this stuff all the time and we wonder why we're so conflicted. We need to say what he says,
yes.
What the Spirit says. Amen?
Amen?
And we'll see. We'll begin to walk in the truth. Amen?
Amen?
Praise the Lord. God bless you. Have a great week. See you back here. Those can be here Wednesday. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday. Hopefully, everybody will be back from their Labor Day weekend.